The digital divide is real, and actually it's everywhere.
You know, in Africa specifically, we see it. I mean, the digital divide is massive.
Our mission is, you know, to keep pushing until we've connected everybody, not just the fortunate few that happen to be in the right zip code.
The bottom line is, the only real choice here was to start from scratch. As it is in the Valley, you have to have some combination of experience and optimism in order to do something like this, because you embark on a journey that is undoubtedly going to be twists and turns, is going to be tough, but if you're going to do this, the right way to do it is to start from scratch. Rethink everything. First principles, right? Not go back to grab a Wi-Fi chip or grab a 4G chip, but start at the beginning, and that's exactly what this team did. Reassess all the possibilities, because as Moore's Law evolves, as technology evolves, you can do more. And that's the story of the Valley is, you know, every generation, something changes where you can do something that previously was not possible. Refactor all the algorithms. This is real tough stuff. This is deep math. This is how do you do the digital signal processing and how do you do the RF and the RF chain and all the pieces of this system to deliver something markedly different. Simulate, iterate, repeat, a lot of invention, a lot of core invention here with algorithms, new algorithms that don't even exist in some of the other technologies. And then after you're done with all of that, you prototype it, you test it, you show it to some customers, then you have arrived at a point where you're allowed to say, let's build a product for fixed wireless. Because in order to hit fixed wireless, you have to build chips. And that's when the company embarked on building G1. What is G1? It's a platform. It's a combination of it's an end-to-end system with a combination of a base node that sits on a cell tower or sits on all-inclusive, you know, device. There's no baseband at the hut. It's all built into one, power in, Ethernet out, and that sits on a cell tower or a water tower or some location, high location, facing the customers that you want to serve. And then there's a remote node, a small little remote node which we have here, and that device sits on a home. And one of the nice things about this system is it doesn't have to be perfectly aimed because there's beamformers on both sides. And there's a completely symmetric system here in terms of capacity and capability. So we deliver with that really fiber-class service. And this is kind of the thing that got intrigued me, was that for the first time, we're getting hundreds of megabits per second per customer. And that's now we're talking about a service that can go the distance for customers. The last thing I'll say is this is all managed by a cloud suite, which is really nice. So it's fully managed end-to-end, so there's no complex installation of software and things like that. It comes up, you're on the system, you can see all the details of the wireless link, what's going on with your customer. It's all built into the system. So what exactly did they get out of all this effort and all this time? Well, first, a fundamental advance in reliable high-speed links without line of sight. This is fundamental. The challenge is that in most places, not all, but in most places, you'll have some obstructions. And those obstructions will cause reflections, refractions, and ultimately will cause a fading of the wireless signal at the cell edge. So line of sight's pretty simple. And most wireless engineers don't get that excited about a line of sight demonstration. You say, hey, here's my gigabit. And it's like, OK, well, not that exciting. What's really exciting is when you can show non-line of sight doing some really magical things. And it's hard. And in order to do this, what you ultimately have to do is you have to do the math to take all of those weak signals that are bouncing off of things and combine them in the digital domain and then create a stronger signal from that set of weaker signals. It's a lot of calculations. It's a lot of math. There's more compute performance in these nodes than there is in any of the other wireless platforms for that very reason. You have to do some really complex things. But what we get out of this is we get the ability to operate with capacity where other systems will start to fail and completely fail, especially at the cell edge where there's a lot of interference and refraction. Another really innovative part of this, and then by the way, there's many more than I have time to cover this morning. Another really innovative part of this technology is that the ability to cancel interference. And not just self-interference, which is hugely important, because in cell systems that overlap, self-interference does become a huge limiter at the periphery. And that, and you end up using a lot of your spectrum trying to deliver service to those cell edges. And if you're thinking about fixed wireless, where you have to have 50 times the bandwidth, if you're burning your spectrum, basically dealing with those cell edges, you don't have enough capacity for the rest of your subscribers, and it ends up being a real problem. This is one of the problems with fixed wireless fundamentally has been limiting. It's almost success breeds a limitation. In other words, more success you have, the less you can do because you can't continue to populate the systems. But the other magical thing here, which is well beyond anything that's out there right now, is canceling an unlicensed spectrum, canceling asynchronous interference. That is, not canceling your interference or interference that you're synchronous with, but asynchronous interference, any interfere. And if you're going to operate an unlicensed spectrum, you almost have to do this because there's no other way to guarantee a service that's sufficient quality for a home internet service. So with COVID, with everybody running all their lives on these systems, it's no longer adequate to say, yeah, it works most of the time. It's got to work all the time. This event is really talking about commercial availability of G1, because G1 is now not only shipping, but it's installed in a quite wide variety of customers, many of which are here today. We're really thankful for that. These are two sectors. One is in with Resound, one of our customers who are here today, and one is with Whisper. And you can see 101 RNs on one, 79 are remote nodes on another. Now, what this is actually a graph of signal noise ratios. So what it's showing is all of these links. And the important thing, it's a bit of a geeky slide, so I apologize for those of you that are not deep into the engineering, but I'll try to make it a bit simple. The colors represent how non-line of sight or how much path loss there is from what would have been a line of sight link. So where you can see there, if it's blue, it's a clean link. That means, you know, there's nothing in the way. It's just the distance is all that's creating the path loss. As it gets more and more green, yellow, and then red, those are pretty seriously obscured links. And this is measured. This is not a planning tool. This is measured from our own systems. So basically, what we're showing is the path loss on each of these systems, on each of these links. What you can see is we can offer services across a pretty broad sector. Not everybody's going to take them. Somebody might want 25, somebody might want 100, some people might want 400. Our customers are actually offering 400 and 500 meg services now. And as you can see, on a link basis, a very high percentage of these links are capable of really, really high bandwidths. This is really the difference.
Hi, everyone. We're here for the demonstration part of our program. So what we have here is a 5.8 gigahertz unlicensed link with our base station located far in the distance. And over here on our van, we have a 5.8 remote node. This is a non-line of sight link. We have a number of trees and a building in between. What we've done is actually to take 10 laptops and 2 access points, force them in the same exact channel with our link, sending traffic at maximum speed, competing for the channel, and obviously stomping over our link. And you can see it here because the receive signal is not just a flat line. It's a bunch of noise. Throughput crumbles down to a measly 15 megabits a second.
Still better than my DSL link at home, though, I would point
out. That's right, that's right. So this is where our other unique piece comes into play, which is ABIC, which deals with this asynchronous burst in nature of unlicensed interference and is able to, in real time, cancel interference from all of these guys with minimal impact. Turn on ABIC. Okay. You look at the capacity of the link, it's 640 megs, and you look at the constellation here. The constellation that we're using is a fairly clean 256 cam constellation. If you're used to looking at that, you'll appreciate it. This is actually very clean. And you're seeing a throughput, a downlink of 560 megaseconds, even though we're hammering this link with massive amounts of interference, much stronger than our signal, coming from all these random directions and asynchronous.
This, of course, is an incredibly remarkable result. I mean, when you see this thing step up and the different algorithms play their role and do this real time with interference, non-line of sight, it's pretty amazing.
Dazzle, we would never have deployed a wireless network if it wasn't for Toronto, because South Africa specifically is very, very full of 5 gigahertz. It's the primary sort of wireless spectrum that we utilize at the moment. And, you know, we spent the whole of 2020 testing the Toronto product. And we took an entire year and we put it through, you know, 75 different tests that we wanted to make sure that it adhered to. And I think that was the nice thing, is that every single thing we threw at it, it absolutely ticked the box. So, and interference cancellation was the number one thing that we wanted to see and make sure that it worked. That was primary. And then obviously the line of sight to non-line of sight to near line of sight was important. But the interference cancellation was the primary test that we wanted to understand and then make sure that it actually did mitigate. And the product came through with flying colors. So I think that's a, you know, in an environment where there is a hell of a lot of interference on 5.8, we've proven that the Toronto product works extremely well.
What are your thoughts about kind of going into a fairly good-sized metro and just saying, hey, here's a new service, and we can offer it ubiquitously in a decent-sized area?
Yeah, my short answer to that is absolutely. Because before, with fixed wireless, you kind of mentioned it in your intro, and Neil mentioned it, we couldn't scale. So you crumbled under your own success. Yeah. Oh, look, I added all these customers. Ooh, I don't have enough spectrum now, or I can only do this many customers per base station. What do you have? And now you flip the script on that. And now I can say, well, I don't want to forget my rural market, but I'm going to go back into these urban markets, urban, suburban, and pick up. I mean, the ISP industry is ripe for the picking. I mean, have you ever met anybody who likes their ISP? Right? I mean, really. And there's a model
you
in there.
You come to the UK.
Right? Yeah.
Everybody loves us.
Okay. In America, have you? So when you look at that, it makes a huge opportunity where we always shied away from those areas because we were going after the unserved. We were going after when nobody has a choice, you can do it with fixed wireless. But now it opens the market so much for us, and we're super excited. Again, we have several of our towers that are, you know, in the getting to the rural market, but in the process, we go past a whole bunch of, and that's why we're offering 400 meg service.
Right.
And these customers are like, wow, they really don't even care what the technology is. They just care that we can offer it and it works.
Having something where you've got, you know, a lot of reach to play with and still being able to offer what we call an ultra fast service, so a service greater than 100 megabits per second, is hugely valuable.
We were several weeks ago delivering full gig down and 500 meg up at actually doing it very well at 3 miles, and we're achieving it at 5 miles also. We were a bit of a non-believer in the beginning. We heard the story and the pitch, and we had heard it before, but we are a believer now. We think Toronto plays a very key role in our future network build-out.
I tell you what, when it gets plugged in and up and running and you see how well it actually works, it's almost amusing to watch the gotcha moment of those folks that when they see this platform up and running.
Most manufacturers, they tell you what it can do, and then you hope and pray you get 50% of that, and then when you get 50% of that, you're happy. This one, it's like, whoa, wait a minute. You actually said it was going to do that, and you know some of the numbers you had up there, we're pushing 8 miles non-line of sight at 300 meg. Now, it's not a forest, but it's a whole bunch of trees. 350 meg down by 80 meg up, the testing we did last week with the CBRS version, just mind-blowing, amazing what it's able to do, and it is the real thing. And we jumped on it as fast as we could because it changes the whole directory or direction of where we're going and how we're going to be able to grow our company.
So we're running a pilot right now. And the first, you know, after a day of running this, the customer that we're piloting with is, you're not going to turn this off, are you?
Yeah.
It's a very sticky product.
How many sites do we have in South Africa right now? Calvin, that's one to you.
Yeah, we got about 150 live at the moment. The great thing about that is that, you know, those 150 towers, we aim to hit about 400 by the end of the year. Those 400 towers will match the current fiber footprint of homes passed in South Africa. So it's a ridiculous metric when you look at it. You know, with 400 towers, we basically match the current fiber footprint from homes passed. So it's a fantastic technology.
Every 5-10 years, technology advances and the right set of people come together and they say, wait a minute, we can do this differently. We can do something magical. And this is one of those moments.